Before the COVID-19 pandemic forced many non-essential businesses to close in March of 2020, New York's Chinatown business districts were already beginning to see a steep decline in sales due to coronavirus fears and a reduction of tourists. The financial hit was made worse by a disturbing increase in reports of anti-Asian hate crimes, which have spiked in recent months. NewsHour Weekend's Laura Fong visited businesses that have started to fully reopen again in Manhattan's historic Chinatown and the Flushing District in Queens, home to the largest population of Asian residents in the city.
A year ago, Manhattan's Chinatown looked like this. But now, it's starting to come to life again. Restaurant owner Johnny Liu is thrilled he can fully reopen indoor dining. For 33 years, Golden Unicorn has been a popular dim sum parlor for large gatherings and a meetup spot for locals and out-of-town visitors alike.
Friends come here to have tea and chat. We do wedding parties and birthday parties. So many people unite here and socialize and meet friends.
But the COVID-19 crisis and citywide shutdown of indoor dining and other establishments forced many businesses to close for good. Golden Unicorn saw a dramatic 90% drop in revenue in the first few months of the pandemic. The two-story restaurant depended heavily on parties in its event space.
Menu? Okay.
Without that revenue, Liu rented a new space at the street level to pivot to a takeout business, and in July, set up an outdoor dining space following strict protocols, hoping to stem the losses. But some Chinatown businesses are closing earlier than pre-pandemic times, in part because of the uptick in violent incidents targeting Asians. 47 anti-Asian hate crimes have been confirmed by the New York City Police Department in the first few months of 2021. That's an increase from 33 last year.
Have anti-Asian attacks created an environment where people are scared to go out after night?
Yes, because for many people who come to work, they live in Brooklyn and Staten Island, because they use the subway at night. For attacks against Asians, I think it is a major cause. Employees are also worried that if they go back too late, they fear being attacked.
Indoor dining was reopened to 100% capacity on May 19th, but one of two dining floors at Golden Unicorn has largely sat empty.
When do you think this will be filled again? When are you hoping?
Maybe August.
August?
In the meantime, two forgivable loans from the Small Business Administration's Paycheck Protection Program, known as PPP, have become a lifeline for the restaurant.
Because our PPP was approved for the first time and the second time, it allowed us to survive. 60% of the PPP can pay employees' wages, and there are 40% that you can use to pay rent and electricity and water bills, so we can maintain the operation.
The effect of the COVID-19 pandemic on Asian business owners has been acute. A Federal Reserve survey found that 93% of Asian business owners nationwide reported a decline in sales last year. And according to a McKinsey analysis, Asian business owners make up a large percentage of hard-hit sectors, 25% of food and accommodation services, and 16% of retail. Unlike Golden Unicorn, many small businesses were left out of the first round of the Paycheck Protection Program. Janelle Dorse is commissioner of New York City's Department of Small Business Services. The agency connects business owners to PPP loans, as well as city-funded loans and grants.
The PPP program brought about $25 billion into the city as of January of this year, but we still saw that we were still missing, based upon the number of businesses and number of employees, about $3 billion that did not come into the city, right?
Do you think that there should be, you know, any particular funds designated for Asian-owned businesses that have struggled?
We saw an increase, of course, in hate crimes. I've personally walked corridors and in our Chinatown districts across the city and spoke to those business owners and heard from them personally the struggle that they're dealing with, one on the economic side, but also just being subject to racism and xenophobia. Right? We have helped and assisted over 700 or so grants and loans to our small businesses in the Asian American areas and zip codes around the city to $10.4 million.
We think hundreds and hundreds of businesses closed.
Thomas Yu is co-executive director of Asian Americans for Equality, a nonprofit that had existing relationships with Asian-owned businesses and helped facilitate PPP and other loans across the city.
We have many loan counselors and officers that speak the many different languages and dialects from our borrowers in our communities. And we were asking a lot of city agencies and banks to put money in this pool and get it out the door as quickly as possible. But even that took forever. It didn't happen right away.
Unlike Manhattan's Chinatown that relies heavily on tourism for some of its business, across the river in Queens, the Asian business owners here depend mainly on the local community.
Flushing, Queens is one of the most diverse, if not the most diverse, neighborhood in the entire country. We have over 120 languages that's spoken here.
New York State Assemblymember Ron Kim represents a large part of Flushing. An analysis of Small Business Administration data showed that one Flushing zip code had New York's lowest proportion of eligible businesses receive PPP funding last year.
There was a distrust of the federal government. There wasn't that much communication and an effort to make accessible the loans, the applications, how it works in our own different languages. And also there was bureaucratic layers. I mean, the system, the loans were more structured for traditional big type of companies and left the mom and pop immigrant-owned small businesses behind.
The latest round of PPP funding under the Biden administration prioritized smaller businesses, as well as women and minority business owners, who were largely underserved in the first two rounds of funding. One of the largest Asian indoor malls in the U.S. is located in downtown Flushing. Retail stores partially reopened in September, and the popular indoor food court is starting to see a return of customers. William Shao is vice president of New World Mall. He said many retail shops have been able to return with the help of federal PPP loans and city assistance.
And we've been closed for a while. Lifting a lot of the restrictions have been helpful, you know, and a lot of people have been vaccinated. It's given more customers opportunity to come out without the fear of getting COVID.
Assemblymember Kim said the direct stimulus checks in the latest round of federal funding has been crucial to jumpstarting the local economy. But in the long term, Kim says progressive taxation policies are needed to fill in the gaps. New York State lawmakers recently passed a tax increase on individuals making over $1 million in annual income, which is expected to raise an extra $4.3 billion a year.
We want sustainable revenue that's going to go to our schools, that's going to go to our social programs, and all the things that matter, public infrastructure, public housing. That needs consistent revenue streams.
Back in Manhattan's historic Chinatown, Thomas Yu thinks the future will depend on bringing in new types of business.
Maybe we can think about an arts economy, education-based economy that could bring people back in other ways, especially other second generation, third generation Asian Americans that if they aren't coming back for food or the occasional visit, they need something more constant to come back for, and I think that's something that is really important.
Johnny Liu is optimistic that Golden Unicorn will rebound.
I like to do this kind of business and dining. That is why I do this business. I like the lively atmosphere because I feel very happy. It means
I enjoy my job.